Okay, so we start as usual. Is there any question? Yes.
Yeah, I have a question. Okay, in the Second World War, the US Army threw the atomic bomb on Japan. Okay, then from that event, we have like the evolution of new disease. And like now we can learn like new baby with like the heart, lung, and all this. I wish to know that when the ecologists, like the evolutionists, doing their theory, did they try to take into account like rare event?
Like a rare event, maybe?
Like event that normally does not have to happen, but that happened.
But in terms of like the generation of new mutations,
Yeah,
or
like because like most of the thing is like long time scale. But you know that something can happen.
Okay, so let me try to rephrase the question to see if it's correct, but also so people can hear it. So the question is that there are events that can happen, like the example was the atomic bomb in Japan, where the radiation produced a lot of mutations. And the question is whether these events are taken into account in the evolutionary theory, because they, of course, they may affect the long-term outcome of evolution. I think this is hard to answer to this question, in the sense that I mean, when you look at, okay, I'll try to answer. I don't know if this is a satisfactory answer. So this doesn't apply to evolution, only to evolution. I mean, but there are many events. Let's say, when you look at very long time scales, sometimes there are very, as you say, these events that have a huge impact on the planet or on life, and are caused by something that is very contingent. So, just an example. So, the extinction of dinosaurs, it's something that happened probably because of meteorite hitting the Earth, and of course that's an event that, well, there are many meteorites, but it's very unlikely that there is one which is big enough to cause the consequences that that one caused, and that of course caused many. So, can you, in some sense, predict if you were replaying the tape of the history of life on Earth, could you predict that event, or can you say, let's say, can you forecast how life is going to be in 2 billion years? Well, the answer is no, because you cannot, you don't have access to these extreme rare events that have huge consequences. On the other hand, that doesn't mean that you cannot say anything, right? So you, I mean, you still, I mean, you don't know these events, but you know, you can describe what happens following these events in ecological and evolutionary terms. So you know that, for instance, that particular event caused a chain of extinction, which actually didn't happen in a few days, happened over millions of years. But they caused a chain of extinctions because all species are entangled together because they interact. So if one species goes extinct, other species go extinct as a consequence because there are not resources for them, etc., etc. So you cannot forecast the trigger, but you can understand and predict and describe what happens after the trigger. I don't know if this answered the question. So I mean, yeah. So when there are these, they are called sometimes black swans events, where they are very rare but very big in terms of consequences. You cannot predict the events itself, but you can predict what happens as a consequence of them, or you can describe what happens. I mean, the specific, I don't know if this was the question you asked. In the specific example of the radiation, I mean, it's very well known what radiation does in terms of increasing basically the mutation rate, and so this is well described. For instance, it has been used a lot for crops. So in the 50s especially, I mean, all the, for instance, all the pasta wheat is made with the durum wheat, which is a particular type of wheat. And there are different strains, but the strains that is most common now was created in the 50s by exposing the species that were present, the strains that were present there, to high level of radiation, and these to in order to increase the mutation rate and then select better crops. So this has been used and it's used. So again, you cannot, let's say, you cannot say if I had in the if you were living 100 billion years ago, millions years ago, you could say, oh, this is what would happen to the life on Earth due to a meteorite falling on Earth. But if you tell me, oh, there is a meteorite that falls on Earth, one can describe and predict what happens. No. And the same with radiation, right? You cannot say, oh, I predict 20 years before the end of the Second World War that there is going to be a bomb, an atomic bomb in Nagasaki and Hiroshima. But if I know that, I can predict what are the consequences, the physiological consequences. Or Chernobyl, or okay. Other questions? So, what are we gonna do today? To start to write simple equations that take into account these different evolutionary forces that I've been introducing in the past couple of lectures. Again, as I said multiple times. This description, the kind of models that we're going to consider are models of microevolution. So in general, we are thinking of a population of individuals that compete for the same resources, that are very similar to each other, but they differ in some small details. And these small details contribute to, for instance, to a slightly different fitness, and these cause, as a consequence, the fact that these different subtypes that we have in the population amplify or the opposite inside the population, so that the frequency of the different types change over time. So what we can imagine is that we have something. What they want to do now is take an approach that is basically equivalent to what we have been doing in the first part of this course, and they consider some sort of differential equations that describes the change in frequency of different types. So now I'm not describing how these different types emerge due to mutations. I'm assuming that there is a population and there is some abundance of a type I, where I goes to 1 to S. And again, I'm thinking that these are not different species, so that they have occupy different ecological niches. I think that they are different types of the same population. And well, in general, I might want to write some equation for n dot I. Yes, you can see that. But as I said, I'm interested in the frequencies of these populations. So I'm not interested in the total abundance, but I'm saying, well, there is some total abundance will change accordingly to this equation, where there is a total abundance which is defined by this, and of course n dot is just the sum over I of n I dot. And what I'm interested in is how xi, so the frequency of a particular type, change over time. So I'm saying there is this population of individuals of abundance capital N, and this capital N is doing whatever it is doing, and I'm not interested in describing this capital N. I'm interested in zooming in inside the population and look at the differences inside the population and see what is the relative frequency of each of the types. Okay? So I'm not interested in, let's say, just to give an example of something that is on the newspaper in these days, I'm not interested in the total number of people that are infected with COVID, that have COVID. I'm interested in the total number that people are infected. I'm interested in the frequency of different variants. Okay, how many people have Delta variant? How many have Omicron variant? Alpha, blah blah blah. Okay. So of course I can write an equation for x dot I, and this is just n dot I over n minus n dot over n times ni over n. Okay. So let's consider, for instance, a very simple equation, the simplest equation you can write. So you have different types, and they grow with a different, they grow exponentially with a different growth rate. Okay. And so, any doubt about this? Sorry, we're all looking at this a little bit puzzled. So the derivative of this, let me do the step. So xi dot, well, what I'm writing is the derivative of t of xi, okay? So I'm deriving the numerator first and then the denominator. So the denominator, I have a 1 n minus n squared, this times n. Okay, so let's consider the case where these populations grow exponentially. And in this context, I'm thinking that they have a different rate, which can be slightly different, that they don't differ much. And if you want to call this growth rate with a word that we already introduced, and as you can imagine, because I wrote an f, this is what we'll consider as fitness in this case. Okay? So it's the, let's say this population is growing exponentially, so it's the, in this case, it's exactly the average number of offspring that an individual has per capita. Okay? So if we do that, what we get is that x dot I is equal to what? Is equal to f I xi minus, well, let me first write what is n dot. N dot is the sum over I of n dot I, which is just the sum over I of f I n I, which is equal to n sum over I f I x I. Okay? So if I write x dot I, what I get is here I get f I x I, and then here I get an x I, which is this term here. So I get minus xi, which multiplies n dot over n, which is the sum over I fi xi. Okay? Now, if you think about this term here, what is this term? So xi are the frequencies of the different types in the population. So you can think of this as the average fitness of the population, right? So it's these are frequencies, so it's like you can interpret them as probability, so it's the average fitness over the individuals. So this can be written as xi times fi minus the average f, okay? So what you see here is that this equation is called replicator equation, and what you see very clearly here is that if you look at the growth rate, at the growth of the fraction of individuals within that population, the growth is determined by the fitness of the subpopulation of the type compared to the average fitness in the population. So if your fitness is larger than the average, you have a positive growth rate. If it's smaller than the average, you have a negative growth rate. Okay? Now, one can consider different types of equations. So for instance, I can say, well, n dot I is not something growing exponentially, for instance, is something like ni fi minus the sum over j over k. So you say I have this term, which is exactly the exponential term as above, but here I have a competition term where basically all the subtypes compete in the same way. So what matters is the total population. Okay? This is like a generalization of a generalization. Yes, it's a generalization of the logistic group. Okay? So you say each individuals have this different growth rate, but they all compete in the same way. So if you repeat this calculation, what you get is that you get xi, and here you have xi times fi minus, this is just capital N over k, okay? Well, what is a dot here? A dot here is N, f minus N over k, okay? So if you sum over the i's, here you get n times the average f, and here you have n, and n here. So here you have minus xi times f bar minus n over k. So you see that these two terms cancels, and what you get is xi fi minus f bar. Okay? Now you can consider, for instance, other slightly different models. You can say, well, I have something where actually the competition depends on some fj and j over k. And if you repeat the calculation, which is analogous to what we did, you get xi dot xi fi minus f bar. Okay. So in some sense, this equation is quite general, and it's the result of the fact that we consider a population where the individuals compete in a sort of homogeneous way, or don't compete, and they have a difference in fitness. Okay. And what we get is the replicator equation, which has the properties I said before. Okay. Now, something you can do is that you can say, well, suppose that I have a fixed number of types. I can study this equation over time. Okay. So let's say that you have a finite number of types from 1 to s. And you study this equation, what you discover is that, well, there is a unique fixed point, there are many fixed points. All the fixed points are xi equal to 1, so you can consider all the fixed points, and there are s fixed points, which corresponds to some I star where xi star is equal to 1 and xj is equal to 0 if j is different from I star. Okay, so where you have just one species surviving. These are the fixed points. Sorry, yes. And there is only one stable fixed point, which is xi equal to 1 for I equal to the argmax of fi. So basically, where only the species with the highest fitness survives and all the other goes to extinction, okay? Which is pretty trivial as an argument. Okay. Any question about this? Sorry, here it's wrong. Here you have 2 to the s fixed points, which corresponds to all the combination of xi equal to 0, xi different from 0, but there is only one stable fixed point, which is there. All the other ones are unstable. No, that's not, no, sorry, got confused. No, what I said before was correct. You have xi equal to 1 for I equal to I star, and then xj equal to 0 for j different from I star. These are the only fixed parts, sorry. You can see that the other, yeah, okay. But something I want to consider now is instead of solving this system for a particular number of types, to ask a slightly different question and ask, okay, so in this, if I look at this equation, I see that this equation depends on the average fitness, okay? And of course, the average fitness depends on all the FIs and the XI. But what I can think of is asking, okay, suppose that I have many, 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 many types. And what I want to know is how is the average fitness depends on time. Okay? So this, if you want, is something similar to a result that I showed from the long-term evolution experiment when I told you, oh, in this experiment with E. coli, you see that the fitness of this population continuously grows over time. So it's natural to ask this question here, right? I have this population, what is going to happen to the average fitness of the population? So to do this, well, you can calculate the derivative, and this derivative is the derivative over j, xj, fj, okay? And this is, of course, the sum over j, x dot j, fj, okay? Because fj does not depend on time, so the fitness of particular type, what depends on time is the frequency of the particular time. So if you substitute the replicator equation, what you get is the sum over j of xj fj minus f bar times fj, okay? And this is equal to the sum over j xj fj squared minus f bar sum over j xj fj, which is equal to f bar, okay? And this term is equal to what? Well, this is just f squared bar, right? It's the second moment of the fitness, okay? So if you look at this term, you have the second moment of the fitness minus the average to the second power. So this is equal to the variance of the fitness. Okay? So you have this very appealing equation which tells you that the average fitness of a population change over time as proportionally to the variance of the fitness in the population. So this is called Fisher's fundamental theorem, and despite the name, is not fundamental and is not a theorem, but is still intriguing and important to discuss this equation. So as I said, what this tells you is that if you have a population where there is, you can expect that you have a change in fitness only if you have some variability of the fitness, right? So this is quite natural. If all the individuals have the same fitness, you don't, there is no change in the average fitness. So in some way, this is this suggests in a quantitative relationship that the speed at which the fitness change is proportional to how much variation you have in the population, okay? Which is the reason why this is very appealing. It's not fundamental, of course, because there is, I mean, in this equation here, there is no mechanisms to discuss what generates this variation. Right? So you say if you have some variation in the population, the change over time of the average fitness is proportional to the variation, but even if we take this in full generality and abstract it from the point where we started with a fixed number of types, if you think this in full generality, this doesn't tell you where this variation comes from. Okay? So it's not fundamental in the sense that what is missing in that description is, of course, some mechanisms that produce variation, and these mechanisms are mutations. Okay? That are not written here. But nevertheless, it shows this relation between the change of fitness in a population and the variation you have inside it. So any question about this?
These are local equations, right? Because the mean value of f depends on time. So
yes.
If we want to solve it, we will need to add the time dependence, right?
Well, the point, yes, this is the another way to say that this is not fundamental, in the sense that you cannot solve this equation, right? Because here you have an equation for the average that depends on the variance, right? And if I write an equation for the variance, the equation for the variance depends on the fourth moment of the fitness, and the fourth moment of the fitness depends on the fifth moment of the fitness, okay? So without the mechanisms on how this variation is introduced, I cannot close this equation, okay? So I can say, if I have a population and there is some variation and I measure the variation of fitness, I can say how fast is gonna be the change the next time step, okay? But I don't have a closed model where I can describe then how the variance is gonna change at the next step, okay? So if you give a population, I mean, this is still interesting because if I have a snapshot of the population and I know the variability, I can say something about how fast fitness is going to change on average. I mean, how fast the average fitness is going to change. Okay? So it's still something that, given a picture of the population, gives you a prediction of what happens in the next time step. But it's not something where then I can use that to predict everything about the next. I can just do a one-step integration. I cannot integrate this over time, because then the next time step, the average fitness change, but also the variance of the fitness change. Okay. Any question about this? Is this clear what I'm saying? Or
so the point is, it doesn't say how the variance changes.
Exactly. Because the variance change for change, not just because you have selection like here, but also because you have mechanisms that increase the variance, right? You have mutations, and you have genetic drift, and you have other processes. Okay, so if you don't specify these processes, this equation, of course, doesn't tell you the whole story, the full story. Any other question? Okay. So there is a slight another, let's say, important equation which is still useful to have in mind, because it gives you an intuition on how a population is going to change in the next time point, given what is present at this time point in a snapshot of the population. And this equation describes how the fitness is going to change in the next time point, but you might not be interested in knowing how the fitness is going to change, also because it's very hard to measure fitness by itself. It's not that I look at the population and I say, oh, this individual have this fitness, right? I cannot say that. But I can sometimes measure traits, right? So I can say, well, I have each of the type have some traits, which could be how big a cell it is, or how many flagella the cell is, or whatever thing you can quantify in the population. Okay? So you have different types, you quantify this quantity in the population. So you can again say, okay, I have a population, and this population have some variability in this trait. And I can, of course, define the sum over j, qj, xj, as the average value of this quantitative trait. So I'm thinking of something that I can quantify, not something that is a binary property. Okay? And so I can say I look at the average q over time, and what is the average q over time? Well, again, this is the sum over j qj xj dot, which is equal to the sum over j qj, and I have xj fj minus x bar, which then reads the sum over j xj qj fj minus f bar sum over j qj xj, which is q bar, and this term is fq bar, and so this difference is the
covariance.
The covariance. So this is the covariance between f and q. Okay. So this equation is called price equation, and tells you something in some sense similar to this, or more general. Of course, if the trait you are measuring, so q, is the fitness, it reduces to Fisher fundamental theorem, to Fisher equation, but it tells you that if you are measuring a trait and the expected change over time of this trait, so the derivative of the average trait over time, is related to how much that trait is correlated with the fitness and how much variation there is of that trait and fitness. Okay? So it means that d q bar dt is larger. So imagine that you could measure q and f. So if you have a wide spread of q and f and they are correlated, this is larger than a case where you have a wide spread and the two are not correlated. Okay? And is larger than the case where these two are correlated but there is not a wide spread. Okay? So if you have large variation, the speed of change of this trait is going to be larger, and if the things are very correlated with fitness, there is going to be a large variation. Okay? Any question?
What is this P in the covariance?
The covariance? Oh, this is just defined as the...
No, the B. What is the...
Sorry?
Where is the B?
The?
P.
This is Q, sorry. Was a mutation in the vector. Okay. And this is defined, of course, as the average of fq minus the product of the fhs. As I said, for the Fisher equation, and it applies also to the price equation, this does not describe how variation comes into play, so how there starts to be variation. So what we're going to do in the rest of basically our time together is try to discuss the mechanisms that produce the variation in fitness and therefore the change, the variability of a population. Okay? So today I want to start with the simplest possible model. What I want to do today is to discuss one of the mechanisms that produce variation in a population, or better, that affect the variation, not that produce, that affect the amount of variation we have in the population. And this mechanism is something that we have neglected all the time, and that is stochasticity, and what is called genetic drift. Okay? So genetic drift is the stochasticity that comes from the fact that we have discrete individuals and not infinitely large population. This is going to require that we are going to take into account the explicitly the effect of stochasticity, and therefore we have to move to stochastic processes. So in some sense, as I said, we want to quantify the variability in a population, and in order to quantify the variability in a population, so how much individuals are similar or different, we still have the frequency of different types. So a quantity that is useful to introduce is what is called a heterozygosity. Okay. Heterozygosity, which is just the probability that two individuals are different. Okay? So, particularly if you have these frequencies, the heterozygosity is 1 minus the probability that two individuals are the same. And so, what is the probability that I pick two random individuals from the population? They are of the same type. So the probability that both of the individuals are of type I is xi squared. So the probability that two individuals are of the same type is the sum over all the types of this quantity. So this is the probability that two individuals are different. Okay? So this quantity is goes from 0, it's 0 if all the individuals are of the same type, okay, to 1 minus 1 over s squared if all the I are 1 over s. So if you have s types and the frequency of each type is 1 over s, so if they have the same frequency, then of course this is the maximum, because you have 1 over s, 1 over s squared, but you sum s, so it's 1 minus 1 over s, okay? The question I want to ask is, how does this quantity depend on time? Okay? And I want to ask this question in a, let's start with a very simple model, which is the model we have introduced before. Okay. But now I want to make it even simpler, so I don't want to consider the case where there are fitness differences. I want to consider the case where there are no fitness differences. Okay. So if there are no fitness differences, you can realize quite quickly that if you write the equation for x dot I, okay, this equation is equal to zero. Because you you see that this is, you can rewrite this as 1 minus n over k, and then you have n dot equal to n 1 minus n over k, then if you, when you subtract the two terms to calculate this, they cancel each other, so this is zero. You can also understand this because you, there are no differences between between different types, so there is no whatever force that can change the frequency, the relative frequency of the subpopulation of the different types. Okay? So, of course, if that is the case, h of t is expected not to change. Okay? Because the frequency doesn't change, so you expect that in absence of fitness differences, the heterozygosity doesn't change. So, in some sense, as I introduced, we want to consider the, when we are writing this, equation, we are considering somehow implicitly the limit of n going to infinity, or if you want to write it in a, so we are considering the fact that the number, total number of individuals is much larger than 1. And and the question is, if we relax this assumption, do we get the same answer? Okay. So when n is very, very large, do we expect, but not infinite, sorry, when n is finite, do we expect that this still holds? Okay. Now, since I'm asking the question, you know that the answer is going to be no, but if you think a little about it, it's not obvious, right? Because you can naively think that, okay, so I have, if n is infinite, I don't have fluctuations, but when I introduce fluctuations, so when n is finite, what I'm doing is that I will introduce some type of stochasticity, but I could expect that this stochasticity, well, produce fluctuations, but why should this apply, at least for the averages, right? Why is just some additive noise that I add on top of this explanation, but yes, perhaps this is not exactly equal to the one at the beginning, is equal to the one at the beginning plus some fluctuations, but if I take the average and I average out this fluctuation, I might expect that these two are the same, okay? So what I want to do for the rest of today is to convince you that this is not what happened. Okay? Any question? Okay. So in order to convince you that this does not happen, I want to introduce a few different models that take explicitly into account the presence of fluctuations. Okay. So all these models, what all these models assume is that n is finite, but is constant over time. So in some sense, we what we are doing with these models is to assume that this equation here is always at equilibrium, okay? And there is stochasticity, but the stochasticity influence the relative changes of the population, okay? So these models are, you could imagine more complicated models where these change over time as well. These models correspond to the regime where these changes of the total population are much faster than the changes of the frequencies. So in all the models, we're going to assume this. And this assumption, what actually means is that the changes in N are faster than changes in XR. Okay? Any question? Okay. So the first model I want to introduce is called Bright Fisher model, and it assumes that there are different, let's say, capital N individuals, and these individuals are of different types. Okay, so for instance, here we have three different types. Okay, there is the circle type, the square type, and the triangle type. They have different frequencies. Okay, this is 3 over 8, 2 over 8, 3 over 8. Okay, and there are in total 8 individuals. Okay, and this model assumes that the change in the populations happens at discrete time steps, so this is t equal to 0, and then there is t equal to 1. Okay? So time equal to 1. Okay? And this model has stochasticity built in, so it's a stochastic model. So what I have to specify, this is a discrete time model, is the transition probability. So what is the probability of observing a given number of individuals of each type, okay, at time t plus 1, given that the population of individuals were of different types at time t. Okay? So given that I had three individuals of type circle, two of type square, and three of type triangle, what is the probability to observe a given sequence here? Okay? And so for the Bright Fisher model, this is simply a multinomial set. So this is, well, I have that, of course, n is the sum over I of nit for all the times, n is constant. Okay? So this is just n factorial divided the product of ni t plus 1 time ni at time t over n ni at t plus 1. Okay? So let me explain what this equation means. So this ratio here is xi at time t. And so what this means is that you imagine that you have these individuals, okay? And then what you do is that you have to select n, capital N, new individuals at the next time point. Okay? And what you do, you have to select the first individual. So I take this individual at random from the existing population. Circle. Okay? I take another individual at random. Circle. Okay? I take another individual at random. Square. 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 Triangle, triangle, triangle. Well, I didn't take in this order, but I reshuffled so they are here. And so basically what you do is that you have a sampling of the prism population with replacement. Okay? So you have to select 10 individuals and you select them proportionally to the frequency of the previous individuals. So if you want, you have a box with all these individuals. You select one individual, you look at it, okay, then you make a copy and you put in the box at the following time. And you put the previous individual back in the box. You select again another individual, make a copy, new box, to put it back. Okay? So it's sampling with replacement. So if you want a similarity, you can imagine that this is a model where you have discrete time steps, so you have populations that change at discrete time steps, like annual plants. And you can imagine that these plants produce some seeds, and there is no difference between the different types. They produce on average the same number of seeds. So the plants that are gonna appear the next year are just a random sampling of the seeds produced by the previous population. Okay? Is this clear?
The constant here, the number of individuals? Or?
The constant is the total number of individuals. So I have 8 individuals today, 8 individuals tomorrow, 8 individuals 10 years from now. Okay? Yes?
Is there a factorial also
there? Oh, yes, sorry. So if I have only two types, that would be simply a binomial, right? Okay. So what can I do with this? Well, one thing I can do is to calculate the moments. So, for instance, I can calculate what is the average n at t plus 1, okay, of type I. And when I write this average here, I imply that I'm writing it conditioned on having a population at time t. Okay? So, what is the average of the multinomial distribution? N of t, right? So there is no process that changed the average number of individuals. Suppose that you focus only on one type, only on the circle individuals. I have three circle individuals today in the box, and then I have to sample this individual at random. On average, I expect to have at the next time top point the same number of individuals I had at the step before. Okay. I don't know if this is trivial and you're convinced, or it's not trivial and you're not sure. Any question? So this is the average population, which of course can be written as the fact that the average frequencies also are constant, right? I just divide over n. Okay. So this is, if you want, the equivalent of saying that xi dot is equal to zero, right? What this is saying is that on average, I don't expect the frequencies to change. So what I could expect is, well, everything is going to be the same as before, okay? Well, it's useful to calculate the second moment, okay? So you know probably what is the variance of ni of t plus 1, again, conditioned on ni of t. So what is the variance of the multinomial? Is the same as if it was a binomial. So the variance of this, I mean, it's convenient to think in terms of these frequencies xit. So the variance of ni at t plus 1 is n times xi of t, 1 minus xi of t. Okay? So this is the variance of a multinomial, is also the variance of the binomial. Imagine that you have only two types. The variance of this sampling at the next time point is this one. Okay. From which I can easily obtain the second moment of nit plus 1, which is going to be simply the variance plus the moment squared, the first moment squared, which is just equal to n xi of t, 1 minus xi of t, plus n squared xi of t squared. Okay? So this is the variance, and this term is this term squared. Okay? Where I wrote this as n xi. Okay? From this I get that the average xi of t plus 1 squared, which is by definition just the average of ni t plus 1 over n squared, okay, can be obtained just by dividing this over n squared, from which I get xi of t squared plus 1 over n xi of t 1 minus xi of t. Okay? Why did I want to, I didn't say that, but why do I calculated this second term?
For h, right?
Because I want to calculate the average of h. Okay? So what I want to do, okay, before doing that, is it clear what I did here? Not why, but what I did here. So what I did is calculate the first two moments of the distribution. The first two moments of the next generation condition to the present generation. Okay? So what I can do with this is to say, what is h of t plus 1 condition on the, let's say, frequencies at the previous time point. Okay? So this is what? This is cos 1 minus the average, the sum over I xi t plus 1 squared averaged. Okay? Condition on xi and t. So if we substitute what we obtain 1 minus the sum over I xi of t squared. Okay? Minus 1 over n this term here. Okay? The sum over I xi of t, 1 minus xi of t. So this term is h of t. Okay. And this term is minus 1 over n, sum over I xi of t minus sum over I xi of t squared. So this is x.
One.
Okay, so this is 1 minus this term, so this is h of t again. So this is 1 minus 1 over n h of t. what I get here is that this heterozygosity at time t plus 1 conditional on the heterozygosity at time t, so you see that here it appears only h of t, is equal to 1 minus 1 over n h of t. Okay? So this equation implies that the average h of t plus 1 is equal to 1 minus 1 over n the average h of t. Okay? Is this clear, this passage here? Some people, by my experience, for some it's trivial, for others it's not trivial. So the key point here is that you are averaging. So you write x condition to y, okay, is equal to, in this case, ay, okay? Now, if you write the probability of y and you take the average of xy, okay. This is equal to write, well, okay. So this is the quantity I want to write. And what is the x condition on y? This is the integral of dx, p of x condition on y. Okay? X. Clear? Okay. So I want to write this term here, and this term is equal to dx, dy, x, px, dy. I just put the definition of x inside. This is pxy, Bayes' theorem, from which I get the integral in dx, x, integral in dy, p of xy. Okay. And so this is p of x. Is the marginal. And so this is the average x. Okay. So if I average the left side over py, over y, I get the average x, and if I average this over y, I get the average of y. Okay? So I get that from this, x is equal to ay, a the average y. Okay? So this is exactly what I did here. And now this, we can solve it. And what you get is that h of t is equal to 1 minus 1 over n t h of 0. But I'm assuming that h of 0 is some deterministic initial condition. Okay? So now if I'm assuming that n is large and t is large, okay, so this term is small, this term is large, h of t is approximately h of 0 e to the minus t over n. Okay? Now, what is the important comment here? So there are two comments that one could make. The first comment is that this is fundamentally different. It's fundamentally different from the null expectation we had. Okay? What this is telling you is that the heterozygosity is decreasing exponentially over time. Okay? So even if it's true that the first moment that the average frequency don't change over time. Okay. Even if that is true, you see that the heterozygosity, so the diversity of the population, decreases exponentially over time. Does it sound puzzling or not? Okay. Okay. Why that happens? Well, mathematically, you can argue why that happens, right? Because the average heterozygosity is not the average of xi. So the average h is 1 minus the average xi squared, which is different from 1 minus xi squared. So when we say, since this doesn't change over time, this implies the heterozygosity is constant, is because we have something like this implicitly in our mind. Okay? And this is not true. Okay? So the heterozygosity depends on the variance of the population. And what's happening with the variance of the frequencies in the population is that it's true that the population doesn't change on average, but the variance increases over time. Why it increases over time? So if you take that model and you simulate it, suppose that you start from, you have only two types, okay? And you do 20, 20 plus 1, and you go on and on, okay? So at each time step, you sample with the replacement from this population, etc. You do this, and you start, let's say, I'm tracking the frequency of the circles. So here I have the frequency of the circles. Let's call it x. Okay. This is x, this is 1 minus x. Okay? So what happens is that at the beginning I'm at 0.5. Okay? The average over all the trajectories I can generate is it's going to be 0.5. But if I look at one trajectory, what is going to happen is something like this, there are fluctuations, and then the population hits zeros and stays at zero forever. Okay? Then I have another trajectory, and this goes to one and stays at one together forever. Okay? Okay. So what happens to these and all these, when you do one simulation, so one trajectory, you have one of these lines. Okay? So if you do one simulation, what you're going to find is that at the end of the simulation, there is a point where either all of your population is of type circle, or all the individuals are of type square. Okay? And if you repeat this simulation over time, what you find is that on average, I mean, half of the trajectory are going to go to the case where the circle, there are only individuals of type circle. Half of the case is going to be only individuals of type square. But on average, you have half and half. So if you take the average abundance over the trajectories, you have 0.5. But that is not the typical outcome. The typical outcome is either all the individuals are of the one type, or, the average outcome is that all the individuals are of one type, so in that case, all the individuals are of type circle, or none of the individuals are of type circle. Okay? So if you look at the heterozygosity here, okay, so at the initial time point, the heterozygosity of the, so look at one single trajectory, let's say, I look at one single trajectory, okay? The heterozygosity at the beginning is 1 minus 1 over 2, because the probability of taking two individuals that are different is 1 over 2. So if I look at h over time of one particular trajectory, so I'm following the stochasticity of the trajectory, what you have is that it starts at the maximum, which is 1 over 2. Okay? Then here it's decreasing because one population is going up, then it's increasing here when it goes 1 point again to 1 over 2, and then it decreases and it's zero when only one of the population survives. Okay? So you see that this is the this trajectory here. Now, if you have the trajectory that mirrors it, the heterozygosity is going to be something similar to that. Right? And so what you have is that on average, the heterozygosity decreases exponentially over time, while the average population is constant over time. Are you less puzzled? Are you still puzzled? Yes. What is unclear?
No, I understand this, but I don't know, the variety of individuals decreases, right?
Yes.
The reason
why the variety of individuals decreases is because some of the individuals go to extinction. Okay? And they go to extinction because of stochasticity. Because you have fluctuations. Okay? And the key point is that there is no way you can reintroduce them, and therefore you're going to stay there forever. Okay? And once you have that all the individuals are of the same type in this simple model, which of course doesn't include mutations, you're going to have that the heterozygosity decreases and stays there. Okay? So the point is that in this model, without mutation, without fitness differences, the only mechanisms that we have is genetic drift, is stochasticity. And what we see is that already these very simple mechanisms doesn't affect the population as a simple additive noise to our expectation. Okay? What we could expect from a simple additive noise looking at the averages was that the heterozygosity didn't change, but actually changes dramatically over time. This is the first comment I wanted to make. Is that clear? Okay. Okay. Do you have questions? Ask questions if you have. Don't hesitate. Okay. The second comment I want to make is that what you see here is that this decreases exponentially over time, okay? And the term here is T over N, okay? So this sort of clarifies in what sense the deterministic limit is a limit for N going to infinity. So the key point is that if, the effect of genetic drift, okay, becomes weaker and weaker as the population size increases, okay. But the key point is that, so if you take this expression and you take the limit on n going to infinity, okay, this becomes zero, and you get h of t equal to h of zero, okay, which recovers the, let's say, naive expectation. Okay. So the key point is that the naive expectation is what you get if you are considering, let's say, t over n much lower than 1, so times that are much lower than the population size. Okay. So for times lower than the population size, you see that the over those time scales, the heterozygosity doesn't change much. Okay. So what this tells us, and the deep point about this that I don't know if I'd be able to convey, well, is that when we take the limit of n going to infinity, so when we say, well, this is true, okay, I mean, xi of t plus 1 is xi of t plus some noise, okay, and this noise tends to 0, as n goes to infinity, okay? So when we say this, when we say we can neglect this noise, okay, and then we look at the dynamics, we are implicitly doing taking one limit and going to infinity, assuming that the time is finite when we take this limit. Okay? I didn't explain myself well. Let me try again. The point is the following. So, imagine that you look at the previous model, the model, the Bright-Fisher model, where you have these extractions, right? And you look at the frequency of the type circle, okay, in a population where you keep the frequency constant but you increase the total number of individuals. So let's say that you have 0.5 individuals at time t, and you look at what happens at the next time point. Okay? So at the next time point, you are going to have a given number of individuals, which on average is, whose frequency is on average 0.5. Okay. So if you look at the distribution of the number of individuals of type circle at the next time point, okay, this is going to be centered in n of 0, in n of circles at time at the previous time point, with some distribution that is actually binomial, okay. And this distribution is going to be picked at that point with some variability. Okay? So the variability of this distribution, the range of this distribution, is order 1 over square root of n. Okay? Because this is a binomial distribution. Suppose that n is large, this n here is large enough, the variability of the individuals of a given type at the next time point is order 1 over square root of n. We calculate the mean and the variance, right? This variance is order square root of n. Okay? So this is order n, and this is square root of n. Okay? So the relative width of this distribution compared to the average is something that decreases as 1 over square root of n. Okay? So if what I mean is that, suppose that now I'm looking at the probability of the frequencies as a function of the frequencies, okay? So I'm not looking at n of t. This is something that is picked, and this distribution here, the one for the frequencies, is 1 over square root of n. Okay? Is it clear? I feel I'm in a corner. So you just take the binomial distribution, right? You just take P of N0 or N T plus 1 condition on N of T, and this is just the binomial distribution, okay? Where this is N of 0 t plus 1 x t to the nt x 1 minus x n minus n t plus 1. Okay, so this is a binomial distribution. Okay, and what I'm looking at is the probability, instead of writing the probability of the total number of individuals, the probability of observing a given frequency of the individuals. Okay. So this quantity here is something like this. So the binomial distribution, when n, small n, is large enough, is something that looks like a Gaussian distribution. And the mean here is going to be the population at the previous time step. And the variance here is going to be something that is proportional to the square root of n. Okay? So when you go to frequencies, okay, you divide both of these by n, and so the frequency at the next time step is going to be picked centered in the frequencies at the previous time step. So this, okay, with a distribution whose variance is going to be 1 over the square root of n. Okay? So as you increase n, the variance of this distribution, the standard deviation, decreases over time. Okay. So you can think of this as I have x at t plus 1, this is xt plus some noise, where the noise is this variability here, and this variability decreases, goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So the key point is that you have some you can think of having some equation like this that determines the dynamics, okay? This is just the rewriting that. And you could say, well, but the variability that I have at each time step is negligible when n is large enough. Okay. The key point is that if you say, oh, I neglect this variability and then I integrate the dynamics, you are implicitly assuming this point. Okay. This corresponds to do a change of limit, right? So you are assuming that the limit of n goes to infinity faster than the limit of large times. Instead, if you take into account the noise, you discover that for large enough times, you see that effect of that is a small effect because n is large becomes non-negligible anymore. Any question on this? Yes.
Can we say that when d is much smaller than n, we are just watching the first part
yes.
of the simulation?
Yes. Yeah. So exactly. So this. If you want this simulation, is t much smaller than n, and this is t comparable to n. So the time it takes to see this pattern here, it's order n, yes.
But how do you compare t and n? I mean, like, they are two different units.
Well, in this case, they are not two different units because the time is discrete. So it's a set of steps. We're going to consider, next time, a case where you have units, and what happens here is that you have, this is actually proportional to array times t. Okay. So if you want, you can think in this case, okay, so before going to that, is this, do you have a question on this? I will not ask anymore if this is clear, because probably the answer is no, but do you have a question on this that you want to ask now compared to when you rewatch this? Okay. Answering to your question, if you are uncomfortable in calling this time, in this case, when you go from time to time t plus 1, this is one generation, you can think, right? So you, if you think of the model where you have the individuals, and the next time point, you have another group of individuals, you can think of this as reproduction, right? There are individuals that reproduct and produce different number of offspring by chance. And so this is one generation, okay? So if you are uncomfortable in calling this time, you can think that this time is measuring unit of generations, okay? If you want, this is number of generations, so how many generations has passed, okay? And in this model, you see that they are equivalent, right? So if you take an individual here, they are connected to one step to the previous time point. Okay. And if you go here, you have this every individual has the same number of generations that are connected to the initial populations. Any other question?
Now that you say that, yes. It makes sense to think that change is really slow, right?
This change is really slow,
right?
So the number of generation has to be comparable to the number of to the population size. So this was exactly the point where the next thing I wanted to comment is that if you uh, So you can, what you can ask is, so the two comments were, the first one is that genetic drift destroys diversity, okay? So over time, it produced a net decrease of heterozygosity. The second comment is that this destruction of diversity is weak for large enough populations. So it's present, but it's weak. So for instance, you can ask how much time it takes to make the heterozygosity equal to half, the initial one, okay? So this is the point where H0 is E to the 1/2 over N, and of course this is equal to N log 2, right? And that means that if you have a population, well, if you have, basically they are of the same order of N, right? So if you have a population order 10 to the 6, you need 10 to the 6 generations to half the heterozygote, right? Which, I mean, if you think about, I mean, imagine that you are considering humans and you consider a population of millions of individuals, which is what we experience for most of our history as a species. It means that it takes, I mean, assuming that one generation is about 20 years, it means that it takes about a little, I mean, 10 to the 7 years, basically. Okay. So it takes about 10 to the 6 generations. So generations is about 20 years. Here there is 1.4, there is a 2 here, but it's on, of the order of 10 to 7 years, which is order of 10 million years. So it's a huge time point compared to the history of our species. Okay, just to half the heterozygosity. So you're looking at really, really, really long time points. I mean, given that, sorry, given I didn't say that, but given that the first Homo sapiens appeared about 300,000 years ago. Okay, so this time is longer than the times that separate us to other Homo species. So you see that over that time point, I mean, there are many other forces that that produce diversity that becomes more important. So there is this change, but this change is very slow. Okay. Any other question? Okay, so I think it's a good, since we didn't take the break, because I forgot, I think it's a good point to stop. So what we're going to do next time is to basically repeat the same calculation with different models, and what we're going to find is that we're going to find the same result. Okay. Good.